One more.
No.
One more.
I still don't see one more song before you sleep. One more. It's about
three. Good afternoon. Happy Sabbath. Indeed, it is a very blessed Sabbath, especially this afternoon, as we will be having a fully packed Adventist youth service here in MAMC Church, which is a rare thing to see. I just would like to welcome everyone in our very special AY service this afternoon. Most especially, as was mentioned earlier, students from AP, students from MAMC, from BAC as well, and from the GIG. We have members from the GIG, our sister church in Bikutan. So, a very warm welcome to everyone. I would like to also, I would also like to take this opportunity to thank our participants who wholeheartedly gave their service this afternoon for the song service, and the praise team and Brother Randall De Vera. And for the opening prayer, we have Sister Cheryl De La Cruz, after which was a special, a meditational number by the MAMC Choir, and opening remarks was yours truly. After my remarks will be another song, a messaging song by the MAMC Church Choir, and after which will be the message by our guest speaker. appeal song afterwards by Sister Georgie and Brother Lee, and a closing song and a closing prayer. Our speaker this afternoon is a very humble man of God.
Jump over.
I asked him earlier. He said he needed no introduction, but he currently is working at the General Conference, and despite all of his accomplishments and all the stories we have heard from him, he still remains to as he still wants to be known as just a humble servant of God.
I didn't say that.
So without further ado, later we shall hear from Pastor Pavel.
That's it? Okay. I wonder if I can borrow your choir and take it with me. I have a lot of respect for the elderly and their experience, but I love when I see the young because of their energy and dedication and life. And what God can do through their commitment. It's wonderful what the Bible says, that God is going to put together parents and children, and they are going to work together and finish the work. I was debating and praying to talk about how you can really turn a church around and experience revival, or how to prepare for the final crisis. And so, I hope you don't mind if I take my coat down. If you do mind, I will pray for you. Much better. I was in school in Southern Adventist University, and one of my teachers was called at the school dorm at 2 a.m. One of the classmates, a straight-A student, she was really good, very committed, good student, always getting good grades. She had a knife and she was cutting herself. And she was roaring, not with her voice, but with a deep voice. Leave me alone. This is real. This is real. And the students tried to talk to her and she would jump with a knife. So they called the teacher. And the teacher came. And the teacher said, Lord, what should I do? And God put in his mind, if I tell you the name of the teacher, you all know him. You really all know him. But I'm not going to tell you the name. He prayed for the armor of God. If you remember, the helmet, the sword, the shoes, and so on. Where is it in the Bible? Ephesians chapter 6. And as he prayed for the armor of God, she calmed down. 2 weeks later, she told the teacher, it was darkness in jurul meu. I'm talking Romanian. It was darkness around me. I'm talking tongues. And she said, as you prayed, the pieces of the armor of God, one by one, more and more light came. Jesus is coming soon. Basically, what happened to her, she was a straight-A student, and she came from a poor family. And because of good grades, she got scholarship, she got help, financial help. And she had a very difficult exam, and if she would get a bad grade, she would lose her financial help. And she prayed, Lord, please help me to get a good grade so I can keep getting the money. Please help me get a good grade, please help me get a good grade. And she got a bad grade. And she got angry with God. Why didn't you answer my prayer? Leave me alone. I don't need you anymore. If you don't answer my prayer when I pray, I don't need you. Get out of my life. And God respects our choice. And when God gets out and the place is clean and empty, guess who comes in? If you ever are frustrated with God because you pray and it doesn't seem to happen, you don't seem to get an answer, never ask God to leave. Rather, talk to God openly about your frustration. Don't pretend that you are happy. Oh, I am happy. Because that's fake. God knows your heart. He knows the truth. Job, when he was upset, He said, why do you do that? He was honest, respectfully honest. God wants us to pray in truth and in spirit. You know what that means? To pray in truth means that you pray according to God's word, not according to your decisions and needs and desires. And in spirit, the wind takes my papers and blows them away. And in spirit means that you pray with your mind, with honesty, not formulas, amen. But you think what you pray. You put your heart. Prayer is the opening of the heart to God as to a friend. So God is able to handle your frustrations and emotions, but instead of going to God with honesty, what she did, she said, get out of my life. And Satan took over. She repented, she turned around. By the way, to make a parenthesis right there, she prayed a lot for a good grade. Did it ever happen to you to pray for something, for a job, for whatever, and you don't get an answer? What if you would learn to surrender, to fully surrender? Because the Bible says whoever tries to save something, he'll lose it. And whoever gives it up for me, he will get it. What if you try to surrender your school, surrender your job, surrender your health, surrender your family, leave it with God and trust that he will do better than you do, and you focus on him instead of focusing on your problems? You know why we don't do that? Because while we say with the lips that we trust God, we don't trust him. We don't feel good before we take care of it. And we don't trust God because we don't know him. If we knew him as he is, we would never doubt him. And we don't know him because we don't spend enough time in prayer and study of the word. Do you need power for the laptop? I don't think so, no? Okay. Just pick up if you need something. And so, going back to the story, she struggled more for the school than struggling to get God. Listen, folks, don't go to God for blessings. Go to God for the blesser. Not for the blessings, but for the blesser. Seek him more than you seek his blessings. Because when you get him, in him you get all things. In him you get protection. In him you get help. In him you get everything. When he is in you, Satan cannot touch you unless he allows. And if God allows it, then you need it. Don't go to God to get help. Go to God to get God. We want God to UPS blessings. God doesn't ship mail blessings. There is no greater blessing than to get God. If you who are evil give good gifts to your children, how much more God will give? It says in Matthew, good gifts, but in Luke it says the Holy Spirit, because that's the greatest gift. When Jesus left, he said, I'm going to send you the Comforter. And the Spirit of prophecy says that the greatest, most urgent among all needs is the Holy Spirit. We should pray, we should desire. The Spirit of prophecy says that we are nothing. There is no power, no revival, nothing without the Holy Spirit. God told them to the disciples, don't go to work. Wait and pray until you receive the Holy Spirit. When you receive the Holy Spirit, you receive power. Then you go and work. Peter gave the most horrible, most simple sermon I have heard in my lifetime. There's no sermon. I don't like it. You crucify Jesus, you need to repent. That's so simple. He didn't go to Andrews. It's a simple sermon. 5,000 got baptized. We give complicated sermons. Nobody gets baptized. Why? Because Peter had power. When Peter would walk and his shadow would go over the sick, they would be healed. Peter resurrected Tabitha. He didn't go there and got a funeral sermon and that's it. He said, get up. Why don't we do that? Because we don't have power. Why don't we don't have power? Because we don't have the Holy Spirit. When the Holy Spirit comes, power comes. Do you follow me? That's the greatest need. We have a bunch of programs, but not the Holy Spirit. We need the Holy Spirit. In order to close the work, in order to do anything, we need power. We need a real God, not only a theory. Doctrines are good. They are from the Bible. But unless we have also the God of the doctrines, the God who gave us the doctrines, if you have only the doctrines, Pharisees had the doctrines, but they didn't accept the God of the doctrines. You need to have them both. And so, very simple. You need to surrender fully and trust that when God comes, instead of seeking help, you need to seek God and trust that when God comes, He loves you enough and He knows what you need. Don't you think that He knows? Ellen White says that our prayers are not to inform God. In fact, she says that He knows our problems better than we know our problems. You don't need to tell God what happened. He can tell you what happened. When He comes, He knows your problems. He knows your struggles. He knows the deepest desires and the deepest pain of your heart. He cares to the point that He gave His Son. When He comes, He will take care of things better than you dream. But you need to get Him. You should not focus on needs. You should focus on God. Do you follow me? She focused on school instead of focusing on relationship. I'm going to give you another example. There was a lady in Bucharest when I was a student in construction university. She came to the same church I went to. She had terrible back pain, extreme back pain, and she had a plastic bag here under the skin with morphine, and it would drop a drop of morphine every half an hour or whatever, I don't know, to lower the pain. And she lived in pain all her life, and she would sleep in the night on a chair because she could not lay in bed because of the pain. And she prayed all her life, Lord, please, please take the pain away. Nothing happened. A prophet came to Bucharest. And she heard that He heals people. And she went to the prophet. And she was healed. And she came home healed. No pain. But that night, when she went to sleep, she wanted to pray. And she could not pray. When she wanted to pray, the windows, without any wind, opened. She closed the windows. The closet doors opened. She closed the closet doors. And her books from the bookshelf were all thrown to the ground. She wanted to pray. She had no peace. So she went to the pastor. That pastor is right now in Romania. Director of the Hope Channel or something. Anyway. She went to him. And he said, what happened? She said, well, I went to a prophet and he healed me. And he said, what if that prophet works with Satan, not with God? Can Satan perform miracles? Yes. Oh, yes. When Moses performed miracles with God's power, Pharaoh's sorcerers, or however you call them in English, performed miracles with Satan's power. The Bible says that there will be false prophets. You remember? False Christ. They will perform miracles. It doesn't say false. It says great miracles. To deceive, if possible, the very elect. You remember? Yes, Satan has the power to perform miracles. In fact, Ellen White says that sometimes he can get somebody sick and then heal somebody and then say, follow me. And the pastor said, you need to pray that God would cast Satan away at any price, including the price of your back pay. That night she said, Lord, please cast Satan out of my life, and in Jesus' name, come back into my life, even if my pain would come back. That night she had peace, and the pain came back. Why? I don't know. It's like Paul the Apostle. He prayed that God would take the pain away, you remember? And God said, no, my grace is sufficient. Because if Paul was proud, God needed something to keep him humble. Because it's better for you to suffer than to lose eternity. Do you follow me? And so, I was in my very first district 27 years ago in a town called Red Steel, Oțelul Roșu in Romanian, Red Steel. And there, a prophet came. And he was in front of the Palace of Culture performing miracles. I was there. I saw him. I was coming from the market. My wife sent me with a grocery list. I had the plastic bags, tomatoes, potatoes, onion, everything. Going home, and I see crowds of people. I was curious. I walked by. I've seen some that I've never seen in my life before. People would come to him. Come for a second. Look, watch here. He didn't touch them. He would come with his hand like 20 inches in front of their forehead. Thank you. As soon as he would put his hand, he didn't touch them. They were thrown to the ground, slammed to the ground. I was like, wow! Next one came, I have leg pain. Pew! To the ground. And then they would come up, oh, I have no more pain. In my mind, man, if somebody threw me to the ground, it would break a bone in me or something, you know? And I was like, after he did miracles, he talked to them about no need to follow any law. In God, you are free. And then he said, I have 7 wives. And I am not married to them. I sleep with them because I am a prophet, and the Holy Spirit comes over them, and they make little prophets. So I went to him. I was crazy. I should not have even gone there. But I was young and crazy. I went to him. I said, you are with Satan. You are not with God. He said, who do you think you are to tell me that? I said, hey, my Bible says that to the law and the testimony, if they don't speak that way, there is no light in them. I said, you don't follow God's law and you say you are with God? You have a different God and he's called Satan. He was like, I hate you and your God. Go away. I said, well, I'm going to pray for this city and I'm going to pray that you have no power in this city. Oh, he didn't like it. Does Satan have power?
Yes.
How do you protect yourself from Satan's power? I was in that town. We lived in a tall building. First level, there was like a mall, stores, grocery store, clothing store, you know, a mall. Next level was a doctor. His name was Popescu Claudiu, and his wife was a doctor, Diana Popescu. Next level, it was my family, and above us, it was a family that was not very good family. The father was in prison 22 years for a crime that he committed. He several times beat people. One time he beat several police officers. He beat his wife daily. We heard her screaming daily. She didn't need to use makeup because she was always blue.
Yes.
He was terrible. And they were always screaming and fighting. And so one day, he had 2 girls. One was Mona, she was 13, And one, I forgot her name, she was about 18. The older one, she was involved in witchcraft. One day Mona came to our door, knocked in the door, Mr. Goia? I said, yeah, Mona. My mom says that my dad doesn't give us money for food and we have no more oil. Can you give us a little oil so my mom can cook? I said, absolutely, Mona, come in. We gave her some canola oil or whatever, I don't remember. She left. Next day, Mr. Goia, we have no more sugar. My mom says, can you give us a little sugar? Sure, Mona, come. We gave them sugar. Next day she came back. We have no more bread. Can you give us a bread? Yeah, Mona, take a bread. And then she says, Mr. Goia, I don't understand something. I said, what is it? Why, when I come to your house, you guys always smile and sing? And when I go to my house, we are always screaming and fighting. Can you give me what you have so we have joy and peace in our house too? It moved my heart. So I said, Mona, come in. I said, this is what we have. We have Jesus' presence. And I said, you need Jesus. And she says, can I know him? I said, sure you can. She says, when is he coming? I said, he's here. She says, is he in the bathroom? I said, no, he's right here actually. And she looked around and she was like, really? I cannot see him. I said, yeah, but he can see you. And I said, Mona, can you see the bacteria? No. Can you see the wind? No. But there is bacteria, yes. And there is wind, yes. Well, the same with Jesus. You cannot see him, but you can feel him. She said, wow. So I taught her a few Bible stories. I taught her one song, very simple. Jesus loves me, this I know. You remember?
Yes.
It's good. Leave it alone. It's perfect. Just leave it alone. And she went home. Guess what? She came next day. I said, Mona, what do you need? She said, nothing. I just want more Jesus. So I taught her another Bible story. I don't remember if it was Jonah or Daniel in the lion's den or Noah or Moses. I don't remember. And she came next day. And she said, every Saturday I see you dressed nicely. You go somewhere. Where do you go? I said, well, I go to meet Jesus. Do you see him really face to face? I said, no, but I hear him talking. Can I come? She came to church. Well, well, well. Sunday, somebody knocked in the door very strong. Poo, poo, you know. I opened the door. Mona's dad, he had an axe. When I opened the door, he threw it at me. I did that, and the axe went into the door. And he said, I hate you. I hate your God. I love Satan. I worship Satan. And he said, leave my daughter alone. If not, I'm going to kill her, kill you, your children, your wife, and then I go to prison. I came from prison, I go back. I don't care. That was a tough one. Well, my father taught me that there is a list in Revelation chapter 13 of people who don't make it to heaven. And the top of the list is people who are afraid. If you are afraid, it means that you don't have a God. When you have a God that is real, you are not afraid. So, I was not afraid of communist regime. I was not afraid to have Bibles. I was not afraid in the army. I was like, if God wants me to die, I die regardless what I do. If God wants me to live, I live regardless what they do. So, I don't care, you know. So, I told him, I said, hey, you lost your axe. I took it. Take it back. Go back to your house. Stop teaching them alone. I said, bye. Excuse me. And so, he didn't let Mona go to church anymore. He didn't let Mona come to us anymore. He talked to Mona's sister. Mona's sister took Mona with her to witchcraft. Mona came to us and said, should I go? I said, Mona, don't go. The sister insisted, please, just one time. Mona did go one time. Mona came home demons possessed. And I heard Mona talking deep, like a smoker.
Oh, no, no.
Saying,
I hate Jesus.
And then Mona said, I didn't hate Jesus, I love Jesus.
And then, I hate.
She was talking to herself. And she had two different voices. And she said to me, it's not me. It is him that is in me that says that. And he doesn't want to get out. I said, Mona, did you go to witchcraft? To the witch? Yes, I did. You should not go. Ask Jesus to cast Satan away. Who is Satan? One night, Mona was running through the apartment. I could hear them. My wife and I could not sleep. When we would go to sleep, there was physical pressure pushing on our chest that we could not breathe. Physical, like somebody pushed my chest. So we started to pray and the pressure went away. When we stopped praying, the pressure came back. We started to pray until 2:30 a.m. We kept praying. Every time we prayed, Mona stopped screaming. When we stopped praying, Mona started to scream again. At 2:30, we went to sleep. When we went to sleep, we heard Mona, tup, 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 tup. Click. I heard the window opening, and then the mother, Mona! And I said to my wife, she killed herself. And Dana said, nah. I said, just look. I went to the window, opened the window. Sure enough, Mona jumped off the window from the third floor. On the concrete, on her tummy. As I was looking, I took the telephone to call 911. Guess what? Mona jumped up. And she started to jump and to scream. That's crazy. They took her to hospital and they told me that she had several broken bones in her body, but they could not keep her still. They had to tie her and do injections to calm her down because she had so much power that they could not keep her still. And she was screaming. I went to visit her in hospital. I said, why did you jump off the window? She said, I didn't. I said that I want Jesus back and he threw me out the window. And she said, how can I get rid of him? I said, Mona, when David would play the harp, the evil spirits would leave King Saul. You need to sing songs that I taught you. And I gave her a book for children in Romanian. It's called Flowers and Stars. I said, you sing songs from this book. And you need to read from this Bible, and you need to read from this book. I gave her Christ Object Lesson. I went next day, and she said, this is wonderful. Every time I sing or pray or read from the Bible or from the books you gave me, he goes away. And she says, I'm going to pray all the time. Next day when I went to hospital, the doctor didn't let me in. He said, the father came and said that nobody should be allowed except family. And if somebody comes, he's going to kill us all. And then following week, we moved to America. That was 22 years ago. So I don't know what happened. There is war. There is war. Real war. If God opened your eyes above each one, there are good angels and evil angels fighting for every mind, thought, for every decision, for every word, for every action, for every place that you look, there is war. Satan is trying to get not a big thing from you. Satan is trying to get a small thing. If you today don't pray and don't study, he got you, because when you don't have God's presence, you are vulnerable. And if he can get a little today and a little tomorrow and a little next day, he is going to get you. Because in the final crisis, unless you prepare today, you will not make it. How do you prepare for the greatest crisis in history? You don't have power in yourself to prepare. The Bible says that he who believes that he's strong shall watch. You follow me? Not to fall. How do you protect yourself? How do you protect yourself? You need external protection. Do you see that? external protection. So let me explain a little. In this conflict, you cannot fight the enemy in your own strength. You need external power. If you think you can win, if you are ignorant, if you don't care, if you don't think, if you think you have experience, if you think, oh, I go to church, I am an Adventist, you already lost the battle. Satan doesn't need to work with you. You are his. You need continually external power. And so let me ask you, let's go a little. We do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, powers, against the rulers of darkness, against spiritual hosts in the heavenly places. Now listen carefully, this is important. If Satan was here, visible, you could hit him. You could get a gun and shoot him. But Satan is not at your level and is not visible. So you fight here and he is there. No weapon that you have can touch Satan. You fight against somebody in the heavenly places, somebody invisible. Therefore, you need to be in the heavenly places to be at the same level, and you need to use invisible weapons. Do you understand what I mean? For an invisible enemy, you need invisible weapons. What are those invisible weapons? Bible says that false messiahs and false prophets will appear and perform real signs and wonders to deceive, if possible, the very elect. So, something great and decisive is about to take place. The world is on the verge of a great crisis. There will be a time of trouble like never before. So, I want you to read this part. So closely will the counterfeit resemble the truth that it will be... Now listen carefully. Repeat the word. It will be... What means impossible? It's going to be impossible to distinguish between the true and the false except by the scriptures. Well, let me ask you something then. How much do you study the scripture every day? Do you still have the good habit to study the Bible? How do you study the Bible? Do you read it as a duty? Oh, I read 3 chapters. I did my duty. Or you eat it. Do you understand? When you study the Bible, do you remember what you just read? Because if you don't, just give it up. Stop studying. It's just a form, like Pharisees. They study the scriptures, but they got nothing. When you study the Bible, you need to pray because the Bible is spiritually inspired. Therefore, you need the Spirit to help you understand what the Spirit inspired. You follow me? Spiritual things should be understood spiritually. Therefore, you pray over the Bible and say, Lord, please help me understand. And you don't read 10 chapters and get nothing. You read one verse and pray over it and say, Lord, help me understand. And then you read again the same verse and you pray again and think. And then you read again the same verse and pray again and think. And the more you digest and meditate and reflect on that one verse, the more you understand and you dig deeper and deeper and deeper. And listen, you compare that verse with another verse that talks about the same subject and with the spirit of prophecy that talks about the same subject. And as you put them together, God gives you light. And you read the verse 15, 20, 30 times until you memorize the verse. Because if you memorize one verse today, that's not difficult. You don't have to be smart. If you read the Bible verse 20 times, you know it. And if you memorize one verse today, not much. One verse tomorrow, not much. But after 1 year, you have 360 verses. After 10 years, you know the whole Bible. And the Holy Spirit, when you are in need, will remind you. But if you didn't memorize, there is nothing to remind. I store thy word into my heart that I may not sin against you. You remember the Bible verse? If you don't store it in, there is nothing to recall it out. I store thy word into my heart that I may not sin against you. When you store it in, it comes in the need to protect you from temptations and from discouragement. When you are in need, the Holy Spirit reminds you exactly what you need for that need if you put it in. You put today a verse, tomorrow a verse. After 5 years, when you study here, the Holy Spirit reminds you that and that and that, and all of them that are related to the subject come back. And as you connect them, you have light. That's how you study. And so, back to the subject. Back to the subject. Man, where did I put my remote? I lost it. You need to study the scripture with prayer diligently, because as you study the scripture, you have roots deep into the Bible that nobody can deceive you. You don't prepare for the exam the night before. You prepare for the exam the whole year. You don't prepare for the final crisis when the plagues start. It's too late. You will fall when the persecution comes. You prepare today and tomorrow and every day. Do you understand? If you don't keep up today with those who walk, how you are going to keep up tomorrow with those on the horses? Do you understand? And so, the enemy will deceive how many? How many? Ooh! The whole world by his miracle working power. He will personate angels of light, personate even Christ. And so, there will be an emotional excitement, a mingling of true and false. Satan comes and he doesn't say, hate God. He says, you need to love God. You need to go back to church. You need to love one another. You need to help the poor. And you know what? God loves you. Whatever you do doesn't matter. He's going to mingle false and truth in a way that people will not distinguish. And he will perform miracles and people will be excited. Wow, miracles. And God will perform miracles and Satan will perform miracles. How do you distinguish between false and real? Between false miracles and real miracles? Between false revival and real revival? There will be a real revival and there will be a false, fake revival. How do you distinguish? There will be a real voice of God talking to you and the false voice of Satan talking to you. How do you distinguish between voices? Some people tell me, then I don't listen to any voice. Really? Don't you want to listen to God's voice? The Bible says you'll hear the voice behind you telling you this is the way. Don't you want to hear? Jesus says, my sheep hear my voice. People are so afraid of Satan's voice that they don't even listen to God's voice. And Satan says, that's okay with me if you don't listen to God. You are still mine. And so, how do you distinguish? Men, women, you don't have to worry, only men. Under the influence of the evil spirit, Lord, miracles. Sick will be healed. Are you prepared for the coming trial? For by your sorcery, all nations, how many? All nations, literally all, were deceived. Sorcery in the Greek is pharmakia, that means in translation from Greek, anything that medicates the mind or makes the mind confused. Basically, if you spend too much time with the TV and that makes the mind confused, Satan is using it against you. If you spend too much time worrying for your job and that could make you confused and not have time for Bible, Satan is using that. Whatever distracts you from prayer and study, it's Satan's tool to keep you away from God. And so let's move on. How do you protect yourself? The Bible says there in Ephesians chapter 6, be strong, not in you, but in the Lord and in the power of His might. Be strong in the Lord. In prayer and in His armor. We will not have time to go through all of them. Probably we go through one. My brethren, be strong in the Lord and the power of His might. Listen, as Christ in His humanity sought strength from His Father, so are we to do. Daily we need help and grace and power from above. The only defense against evil is the indwelling of Christ in the heart. Unless we become vitally connected with God, we can never resist. Without me, you can do nothing. Christ in you, the hope of glory. Are you continually connected with Christ. My father used to pray continually. And he told me, son, 1 second you are without Jesus, Satan will attack you. And you don't even know. If you don't do that, are we really Christians? Are we really Adventists? Israel thought they are God's people. Oh, Abraham's children. If we have no real continual connection with God, are we real Adventists or just nominal Adventists? Do you follow me? So closely the counterfeit to resemble the truth that it would be impossible to distinguish except the scriptures. Go to God's word. Go to prayer. By the way, Jesus woke up every day, early in the morning, when it was still dark, and spent time in prayer. And in the book Prayer, in chapter 29, it says that he spent time with the Father until he was filled with God's presence. And then she says in the next paragraph, we should never leave our room before we spend time with God in prayer until we are filled with God's presence. That's real Christianity. It's not when you keep Sabbath. I am not saying that you should not keep Sabbath. We should keep. When you have God's presence, you don't break the Sabbath. But to keep Sabbath without spending time with God is not going to save you. To have only the forms of the church without having a relationship with God is not only when you keep Sabbath, it's not only when you go to church, it's not only when you pray routine prayer, it's not only when you read the Bible to do your duty, is when you spend enough time with God until you are filled with God's presence. Do you understand? Let's move on. Our faith should not depend and be based on miracles or answers on blessings, but on God's word. Let me give you an example here. I've seen people that they love God until bad things happen in their life. When bad things happen, they lost a job, they lost the marriage, they whatever, and they pray, and it seems there is no answer, they get discouraged. And they lose their faith. Should our faith depend on blessings or on a knowledge of God or relationship with God? Job, when he lost his children, he lost his job, he lost his house, he lost his servants, he lost his health, he lost everything in one day. And his wife said, curse God. What did Job say? I got the good things from God, now I got the bad stuff. I still love God. I don't love God for blessings. I love God because He loves me. Do we love God only when things go good, or we love God regardless? My dad used to say, if God was broke, if God had no eternal life, no salvation, no money, if God had no blessing, I would still love Him because He died for me. If my kids love me only when I give them money, that's no love. You know? Should we lose our faith when we go through trials? Should our faith depend on blessings and answers to prayer? Shouldn't our faith depend rather on relationship, that we know Him? And though we may not understand what is going on, we still trust in Him? When we were in Southern, we had no money and no food. My wife and I had several days that we went without food. In fact, we slept on the floor because we didn't have a bed. And I prayed that God would help me get a job, and it didn't happen. And I prayed that God would give us food, and it didn't happen. And I prayed and cried, and it didn't happen. I said, why don't you answer? And still nothing. I didn't get it. Why God would not answer my prayer? I was walking and crying and praying. I remember going in the garden of prayer by a tree in the seminary, and breaking in tears in prayer. Lord, please, I am desperate. Please, I need a job. Please. Nothing happened. Now, years later, I look back. That was the best that God could do for me. Because I was extremely proud. Oh, I have so many degrees. I have 4 bachelor's, 2 master's. I have this and I have that. And I was proud and stubborn like a donkey. I was stubborn. Basically, it was my way. I didn't care if you die or something happened. It was my way, period. And through that suffering, I learned that I am nothing and I am nobody. From being in the top in my country, friend of the prime minister, having a powerful business, having money, I got in a country where I didn't know the language. Americans would talk to me in English, and I didn't know one word in English, and they started to scream, thinking that if they talk louder, I understand English. No. Hey, you can scream, I still don't get it because I don't know English. Stop screaming! You know, they would talk louder, like if you talk louder, then I know English. Doesn't make sense. And I was humiliated and frustrated and humbled. And they would drive a car, I would walk to the school. They had money, I had no food. I was like, what am I doing in America? I want back home. And that humbled me and broke me and taught me to be flexible and taught me to depend on God, not on my wisdom, and taught me to do what God says, not what I say, and taught me to understand people that were poor. Before that, I said, poor people are lazy, because if they were, they have money. I learned that you can be not lazy and still be poor. So God taught me some lessons of compassion and humbleness, and God had to break me before using me. Amen. Do you understand? And I didn't get it. But now looking back, that was the best lesson of my life. And when I learned the lesson, and one night I said, I give up. I give up. If you want to kill me, kill me. I just don't know what to do. I give up. That night, God started, when I gave up and surrendered, He started to work in my life. Basically, God answered with what I really needed. And my problem that I thought was my problem was not my problem. My real problem was different, was what God was addressing. And I was praying that God solves this problem, and God said, that's not your real problem. This is your real problem. Do you understand? And so many times, we look for answers instead of looking for God. And if we don't get answers, we lose our faith because we don't know Him enough to understand that He wants our eternal benefit. And so, saying that, how do you prepare? How do you prepare? You should pray and study and depend on Bible and depend on prayer and depend on relationship. Not depend on blessings, not depend on answers to prayer, not depend on miracles. If miracles don't happen, you should still love God the same. No difference. Like Job. Joseph went to prison. He was innocent. 7 years in prison. Do you want to go to prison? Do you think it's fun? Didn't he pray, Lord, please deliver me? Nothing happened. But he chose to trust God in prison. And God turned it around and put him prime minister over Egypt. Imagine if he got angry with God and gave up God. You never know. You need to trust that God would use that for your best. Because He knows the future. And so... The great last delusion is soon to open before. Satan will perform marvelous works in our sight. So close will be the counterfeit that will be impossible to distinguish. Only those who have fortified the mind with the truth of the Bible will go through the great conflict. Now let me say this. This is very important. It says there, He will bring fire from heaven. But the Bible says, I baptize you with water, but Jesus baptizes you with spirit and Jesus baptizes you with spirit and fire. Satan brings fire. Can you connect them? What is fire? When Elijah wanted to prove that God is the real God, what did he ask for? Fire from heaven. What did the false prophets try to get? Fire from heaven. Okay, let's take another one so you understand. In the Pentecost day, when the disciples received the Holy Spirit, what came from heaven above them? Fire. Am I right? When you receive the Holy Spirit, you receive fire. You receive power. If you don't have that power and that fire, you may think you are a Christian, you may think you are baptized, but when you are baptized with Spirit, you are baptized with fire. If you don't have fire, you never got the real commitment and the real consecration. Ellen White says that those that were really converted, they are in fire for God. And those that are not in fire for God, they may be called Christians, but they have never been truly converted. Let me put it this way. Listen carefully. When I was a kid, I used to take a magnifying glass. You know what is a magnifying glass? That you can, people that don't see well, they can read with it. I used to take a magnifying glass, put papers, and then put the magnifying glass, grasp a ray of the sun, and focus and get one beam on that paper. When I focused the light through the magnifying glass, you know what happened to the paper? The paper got on fire. Well, let me explain it to you. Whatever you focus on, that's what you get on fire for. Let me repeat. Whatever you struggle for, whatever you focus on, whatever you spend your time and your mind with, that's what you get on fire for. If you focus on this world, you get on fire for this world. If you focus on God, you get on fire for God. Are you on fire for God? Because if you are not, it means that you have been focusing in the wrong direction. I don't know you. I am not talking specifically about anybody here. I am talking generally about everybody. We need to be on fire for God. We need to focus so much on our God that we know Him, we love Him with a passion to death, and we are on fire for Him and His work to the point that we are ready to die for Him any moment. And if God says, like to Abraham, move, you move. You don't argue, what's going to happen to my job? When God says move, you say, yes, sir. I don't, well, how am I going to live? He knows. He will provide. He gave Israel manna in the wilderness. He can do that to me. If not, then I die, but I still obey to death. Are you on fire to the point that whatever God says, you do it, and you don't do it gradually. You do it joyfully. You say, this is an honor. Oh, thank you, Lord. That's because we don't focus on God. We focus on anything else. And we think we are okay because we go to church on Sabbath and eat tofu. Folks, those are good things. But unless you have that type of connection with God, to be on fire for God, all your heart, all your mind, to live for God, to die for God, whatever else you do is not going to save us in the last crisis. I baptize you with Spirit and fire. They come together. When you receive Spirit, you receive fire. You receive energy. You receive power. You receive enthusiasm. You receive dedication. If you don't have that, it means you never got the Spirit. And then you need to be baptized again. Or you need to commit your life to Jesus. And say, Lord, I want it. And I'm not going to leave you alone. I'm going to grab you and not let you go before you fill me with your presence. Because the Bible gives you a promise. If you seek me with all your heart, I'm going to let myself be found. If you draw near to me, I will draw near to you. So you go to the Lord and you say, Lord, please, I do have needs. I have problems with my job, I have problems with my health, I have problems with my kids, I have problems with money, I have problems with this and that and that. But Lord, you know those problems. I am not going to ask you for help there because you love me anyway and you are helping me anyway. But one thing I don't give up. About those problems, you do whatever you want. I don't care. But I want you and I am not going to give up. You can kill me, you can do whatever, I am not going to let you go before you fill me with your presence. Lord, come into my heart. Into my heart. Come into my heart. Come today, come tonight, come tomorrow morning, come tomorrow noon, come every day. I am not going to let you go. I want you more than life. I want you more than health. I want you more than house. I want you more than family. I want you more than anything. I want you, period. I can lose everything else. I am willing to give it up. But I'm not going to give up getting you. Please come. Make that your prayer. And you'll see what happens to your life. Then you receive power. If our church would do that, everybody would have power. If we had power, would happen what happened in the disciples' time. That happens when we fully surrender everything else. And we have one and one goal alone. Lord, I want your spirit to fill me with your presence and with fire. Remember, 7 Testimonies, page 30. Quote, to everyone, how many? To everyone that fully surrenders, how much? And then next words. Listen, withholding nothing. To everyone that fully surrenders, withholding nothing, unlimited heavenly power is provided. Unlimited heavenly power? And listen to the next words. For the attainment of measureless results. That's power. To everyone that fully surrenders, withholding nothing, unlimited heavenly power is provided for the attainment of measureless results. You flip two pages later, 7 Testimonies, page 32, and she says, the disciples, after they surrendered in the upper room, then they received the Holy Spirit. When they received the Holy Spirit, they received power and they received energy and fire. When they received that, she says, thousands were baptized. The sick was healed. The dead was resurrected. You remember? And then she says, everything that the disciples did, every church member should do today. That's God's call. That's how you prepare. That's how you fight Satan. Not in your power. We need to be filled with God's Spirit. When you go in the water, you come out wet. When you go in the fire, you come out hot. Are you hot for the Lord? Shouldn't we? Shouldn't we love the Lord to the point that we are in fire for Him? All, how many?
All.
What means all? I looked in Greek, you know what it means in Greek? All. All who dwell on earth will worship the beast. How many are going to worship the beast? Oh, everybody? Listen carefully. The key is the word dwell. All who dwell. Because the word dwell means to think of, to focus on, to live in. All that they focus on earth, all that focus on the earthly things, they all worship the beast. That means that you may think you worship God, but if you focus on earthly things without knowing, you actually worship the beast. Did you hear what I said?
Yes.
You may go to church, you may keep Sabbath, you may do whatever. If you focus on earthly things, you may think that you worship God without knowing that you worship Satan. Because all that dwell, that they spend time. The Bible says, wherever is your treasure, that's where your heart is. Peter says, don't you know that these things will burn up? Jesus is coming soon. The house is going to burn. You don't take the house to heaven. Why do you allow the job and the position and the house to define who you are. Shouldn't God's presence define who we are? And so, many in the church think that they understand the Bible, but they don't know how weak they are. And Jesus will say, I never knew you. Lord, haven't we gone to church? Yes, you did, but you never knew me. Those who focus or dwell on the things of this world, they worship the beast. Jesus says, he who doesn't hate mother and father and job, he doesn't say mother-in-law. That would have been easy. Those who are continually dwelling upon this earth, whose minds are focused, consumed with here, who are in fire for this, instead of being in fire for that, those worship the beast. The Bible says that we should be in the world, but not of the world. The Bible says that we should be citizens of heaven. The Bible says that while we are here, we should be living there. Do you understand? We need to be dwelling in heaven. We need to focus on heaven. We need to focus on God. We need to think about God. We need to talk about God. We need to use every... There is a quotation in the book Prayer, chapter 30, that says, use every opportunity to think about God, to talk about God, to contemplate about God, to sing about God. Focus on that. Love God. Love His appearing. I want you. Folks, I need to cut it short because my voice is giving up on me. I'm going to stop right here. We just did one third of the sermon and I am not about to finish it. Let me give you a story. I like stories. In 1977, March 4th, 1977, there was a very extremely strong earthquake in Romania. It was 7.2 on Richter scale for 1 minute and 16 seconds. It started this way, and then it did this, and then this again. 1 minute and 16 seconds, 7.2 on Richter scale. Very strong. A bunch of buildings collapsed. I saw it. I saw buildings where half of the building was up and half was rubble. And you could see half of the room and a hand that was broken by the wall, cut in the concrete. There were, they say, over 40,000 people buried alive, killed. It was a disaster. When the earthquake started, it was Friday night. We just came from the church. We lived in a tall building at the fourth story. When we got up, the building started to move. It was so strong that it was throwing me from one wall to the other wall. My mom started to pray, Lord, forgive my sins. If I die, I want to be saved. My dad started to sing, Rock of Ages, cleft for me, let me hide myself in thee. And my dad said to my mom, honey, that should have been solved long ago. Let's sing together because we have a wonderful God. And if he wants us to live, 10,000 can fall on the right and 1,000 to the left, we still live. And if he wants us to die, he's going to be a second until we see Jesus. So it's good news. And he told my sister to go to the piano. The piano was moving. To play Rock of Ages. And he had us sing. As soon as we started to sing, somebody knocked in the door. Mr. Goia, open the door! He went to the door. Our next door neighbor, her name was Nuzica. She knocked, can I come in with my husband and my kids? And my father said, everybody is running out. Why do you want to come in? He said, well, there is no salvation out either because the buildings fall on you, killing people. The single safe place is here in your apartment. And my father said, why? And she said, we all know that Jesus lives here. We all know that it's heaven in your house. We all know that Jesus lives here. Isn't that something? We know that it's heaven in your house. My father said, come in heaven. They came in and he said, sit on the floor, I don't have chairs. And he said, sing. And she says, I don't know the song. He said, I'm going to tell you the words. Rock of Ages, pray for me. Rock of Ages. And the earthquake stopped. He said, okay, go home. And he said, you need to get Jesus in your home too if you want to have peace and safety. Do you understand, folks? Christianity is not the forms that we do, but is the real relationship with Christ. Christ in you, the hope of glory. He who has the Son has life. To know Jesus is eternal life. Christianity, it's a real continual relationship with God. It's to live in God's presence and be filled and seek God more than anything else. To be in fire for God, to desire God, to desire His presence, to desire His kingdom, to dream for it, to pray for it. When my wife and I are not together, guess what I do? I talk to her all the time. She can testify that. All the time, I am with her. And when I am not with her, I think about her and dream of her. If you love God, that's what you do. That's what we need to pray for. By the way, isn't it strange that witch people and sorcerers, they talk with spirits and we don't talk to our God? Shouldn't we talk to our God? They hear voices. If I ask my church, do you hear voices? They say, am I crazy? Yes, you need to be crazy. You need to hear voices. The Bible says that my sheep hear my voice. The Bible says you'll hear a voice behind you telling this is the way in Isaiah. The Bible says he who has ears to hear what the Holy Spirit says. Ellen White says that God wants to lead us every second, but because we don't pray enough, we don't distinguish God's voice. The Desire of Ages says when every voice is hushed, the quietness of our soul makes possible to hear the voice of God. He says, be still and know that. You remember? We should hear God's voice every second. We should depend on God every second. We should walk with God every second. God should be real. There is a quotation, I have it there, that says, those, it's extremely, let me look for it. Over every man, women, don't worry, good and evil angels strive. Can you realize that right now there are good and evil angels over you? Now listen. Elisha was on the mountain. And in the morning, the servant wakes up, opens the window, he says, wah! Master, wake up! He says, what? There are armies of enemies around us. What am I going to do? We die. We have problems. We have problems. And Elisha says, Lord, open his eyes. When God opened his eyes, what did he see? Armies of good angels around them. Can you realize that every time, actually, every second, when we are not aware, there are good angels and evil angels around us? I remember I just married my wife. It was in our first year of marriage. We were coming from the church. And I stopped on the sidewalk to talk to some youth from the church. She kept walking to go to the bus station to wait for me a few feet ahead, crossing the road on the other side where the bus station was. As I was talking to these guys, I turned my face and she stepped off the curve. And as she was walking, she looked behind and says, are you coming? And she stepped without looking left and right. And there was a car coming with extreme speed. And I was like, Dana! When I saw the car hitting her. And she stepped in front of the car. And in that moment, I saw her doing like this, like somebody stopped her. And the car and took her coat. And the car pushed the brake and went like 300 feet, spinning. I said, oh God, thank you for saving my wife. And I said, how did you stop? And she says, I didn't. There was a hand physical hand that I felt in my stomach that pushed me back. Who was false? Who did that? The angel of the Lord encamped around those who fear him. My father was canvassing during communism. It was against the law. And the police came to put him in prison and confiscate the books. And my father went in the forest to hide with his friend Benjamin. They were both selling books. He told me he had a bunch of Bibles and great controversies. And the police went to the bridge where you get out of the city. There was a big gorge, very deep with water, and the bridge. And the police knew if he gets out, he has to go on the bridge. They were waiting there for him. And my father went in the forest and he told Benjamin, far in the forest, there is the old bridge. That's how we go. And Benjamin says, that bridge is on two cables and the wood is rotten. It can break with us. And my father said, I am a son of the King of heaven. I am not afraid. They went on that bridge with a backpack full of books. My father goes, I am a son of the King, of the King, of the King. I am a son of the King. It's a song in Romania. And Benjamin behind him, Pavel, stop it! And my father stopped and says, what? And Benjamin says, look down! He looks down, he says, oopsie! He was stepping on nothing. There were six wood boards missing. He stepped on nothing, he stepped on nothing, and then he stepped on wood. And Benjamin says, stop it! He looks and says, oopsie! And Benjamin says, how am I gonna come? He says, well, you need faith. He says, well, I don't have faith. And my father said, then jump. Who kept his feet not to go down? He stepped on air. The Bible says he's gonna send his angels. Folks, there are good angels and evil angels above you, fighting, protecting, attacking. We are not aware, but this is real war. This is real. And if we don't have God's presence, we will not make it. We need to be filled with God's presence. That's our real need. That's what we need to pray for. And that doesn't happen overnight. That's a process. Spiritual growth, to grow from here to the stature of fullness of Christ, is like children grow. Children grow slow. They don't zhup, Children grow slow. People tell me, I've been praying for 2 weeks and I didn't grow. Have you seen a child becoming mature in 2 weeks? You don't pray for 2 weeks. Prayer is the breath of the soul. You don't breathe for 2 weeks. You breathe as long as you want to live. You pray always. Pray without ceasing. Therefore, you pray again and again and again. Come into my life. And as you pray, that it's not an event, it's a process. It's a slow, ongoing process. As you pray, God keeps working on you. And you grow and grow and grow and grow and grow. And you don't see from yesterday to today that you grew. But if you look 5 years behind, you see how God has been working in your life. Therefore, you never stop praying. You understand? Okay, I'm done. No more stories. God is calling his people to this experience. Before Jesus comes, this is the greatest need that we have. We need to be filled with God's presence. We need to be filled with his Spirit. That's our real need. I pray that God is going to help you. Not only pray for that and experience it, but be in fire for him and spread it all over. Let's pray together. Father in heaven, what a privilege that you want the God of the universe to come and live into our hearts. Help us seek you more than anything else. Help us not to look to self and get discouraged that we didn't grow, but keep our eyes on you and trust that you who started will finish this work. We pray this in Jesus' name and thank you, Lord. Amen.